joining us. This is another program of Prime Time. Well, we are doing a first here at Prime Time. We are coming to you live on Zoom, virtual. It's keeping with the times. We are social distancing. And yeah, we don't have to use masks because everybody's in their own space. And it's so wonderful. The persons on our program today, when they first came to Prime Time, they were busy working on launching their new program. And so we are going to move with so many months ahead, and we have invited them again to come in and let's bring us up to speed as to what's happening in government. So stick around and we'll be right back. This is Prime Time.
Make use of web mobile banking with easy access and direct usage of face recognition. PIN code. Or fingerprint. Download web mobile banking app and make your transaction from anywhere at any time. For more information, visit wib-bank.net/quick-login.
At Travel Planners, we love what we do. Every day, we help our clients plan their vacations, from honeymoons to family reunions, trade shows to conventions, school trips to sports tournaments. Our agents at Travel Planners can help you make better, wiser decisions on travel destinations and cruises and find you the lowest fares. Make some memories with help from Travel Planners in Phillipsburg and on the Airport Road, Simpson Bay. Visit our website at PlannersSXM and like us on Facebook at St. Martin Travel Planners. We take care of all your travel needs.
This is Prime Time. We are on Zoom. And this is the first for Prime Time, and we are quite excited to be able to do that and to continue the program as we face these trying times. Joining us in our studio today, we have MP Melissa Gumbs, parliamentarian, and we have MP Raeyhon Peterson as well. Join us from the party, the PFP party, Party for Progress. Wow, the first time you came on, you were pitching your party and what you stood for, and you're in government, even though it's in the opposition, but you still made a big stride for a brand new party. So how are things going? Let me start with MP Gumbs.
Thank you, Beverly, and thank you for having us on again. Indeed, it's been a whirlwind few months. So far, it has been largely what we anticipated in terms of the workload, the reading load, actually, and especially with COVID and everything that has brought up. You know, it's been the kind of work that we expected. From the politics side, it's also been relatively what we anticipated. You know, everyone trying to kind of get their dig in for what they consider is important. But yeah, it's been interesting. Sometimes a little disappointing because, you know, yeah. You really think that everyone is on a certain level and a certain wavelength. Sometimes that's not always the case, but you know, I think especially MP Peterson has done his best to at least bring some kind of legal education to everyone.
So MP Peterson, so how has it been for you? Give us your experiences quickly.
Well, you know, I would have to concur with MP Melissa Gumbs. Thanks for the question again, and thank you for having us. It's kind of been, you know, it's been interesting because, of course, what we expected, you know, when it comes to the personal relationships, I can say that my expectations were met. But when it comes to how we work, of course, we had to, you know, get ready, get adjusted to the Zoom meetings, you know, so that's very different. And at this point, we are used to it. But I'm very anxious to see how things will work out when we actually get to go back to the Legislative Hall, where we will have everybody that we are, you know, speaking with through a screen now in person. So that's I'm looking forward to that one.
Yeah. So how has been? I know that you were diagnosed with COVID-19, and so how are you feeling right now?
Well, I am feeling very good. You know, as I also stated in my statement that I put on Facebook, because I think that I am part of the group that wants to defeat the stigma of COVID-19. Yeah. because I think right now there is a very misconception of how, you know, COVID really works. And, you know, people, you know, there's a lot of people out there who have had it, but, you know, feel ashamed for, you know, contracting it. And MP Gumbs is one of them who also contracted it. And, you know, we decided, you know, both of us that in the case of that, we would be very transparent with the people and to show them that, you know, that it's nothing to be ashamed of. And it is not something that is going away. We have to get used to it. We see that, you know, and fortunately, I was one of the lucky ones that did not have any real symptoms, that did not lose his taste. You know, that those are the kind of things that he heard. But aside from me, you know, also MP Cookie had it, MP Bichlani had it, and he had it a little rougher, you know. So so I do want to take away the stigma, but also want to stress on the importance of trying to prevent it. And if you get it, you know, you have to take measures because it is not something to take lightly.
Right, I see that. So MP Gumbs, how are you feeling?
I'm feeling good.
Apart from all the bush tea that your dad brought for you also, and all those remedies.
Yes, I am feeling good. You know, I am very blessed to have within my extended family several medical professionals who've been on the front lines, even in New York, especially. Okay. So as soon as I, even when I tested negative, you know, my cousins up there were like, self-isolate. They said, lock yourself up in your house. Start taking this, start taking that. And indeed, I did have some symptoms, but they were very mild. I was very happy for that as well, because I've heard some terrible stories. And I'm also very glad to see that MP Cookie is now out of the hospital. And
exactly.
And I wish him continued, you know, recovery from this, because it takes a lot out of you, I think. Yeah, but I am
good. It does. Yep. So we're going to go straight ahead and talk about the advice that was put in that did not reach the Prime Minister's office. And you all were pretty upset. You put a press release about it a couple of days ago. So could you just, for the benefit of our viewers, put us up to speed as to what's happening with that?
Sure. Well, we wrote the press release because Parliament has been asking for these advices for quite some time now. And I think we started to ask in earnest on last week, Monday. That was spearheaded then by MP Bonkamper, who asked, you know, in the group chat that we have for any advices received from the Council of Advice. And we received one dated July 9th, but it was termed a pre-advice because it was an urgently requested advice. So, you know, you think that you hear something called pre-advice that you would anticipate the full thing coming to you later on. But so I inquired, you know, was there another advice sent, and was told no by both, you know, Parliament and government when I inquired. And in the end, it turned out that an advice on dated the July 28th had been sent to the Ministry of General Affairs, to the Prime Minister's office, and on the 3rd of August, and it had been missed. So, you know, we are newcomers to Parliament. Whatever lapses happened in the past, I am not interested in that. I mean, there's a lot, you know, that we can go over that have brought us to these points. But for me right now, it was in this critical time, you know, we can't afford lapses.
Sorry, go ahead. MP Peterson, you want to add on that really quickly before we take a break?
Well, to me, it was very important, as MP Gumbs mentioned, to get the advice from our Council of Advice, because as we stated, those are our high councils of state. That means that any decision that we want to take legislative-wise, it would have to go through that process. And their advice is something that I hold, you know, as somebody that comes from a legal background, that is something that, to my opinion, in first instance, would have to be respected, because you can assume that all legal checks and balances have been made, but if it's coming from our Council of Advice. But some other MPs did not share this sentiment. And of course, we came to understand from government that it was an omission. But like MP Gumbs said, now is not the time to be making, you know, human mistakes, especially if, you know, the email with said advice was sent to multiple people. You have to have some provision in place that guarantees that at this point in this critical COVID time, that all of the checks and balances are put in place. And the law is also clear when it comes to the advices sent to us from the Council of Advice. So me looking at it from a very legal perspective, an apology does not take away the need to hold government accountable for its actions, because if we are lenient, then it's just going to continue. And that is something that we want.
Okay, let's take a break, and then we come back. We'll talk about, I'm sure that you have a list of things that you'd like to see accomplished while in while in parliament, while in opposition. So we'll talk a little bit about that when we come back. Stay tuned and we'll be right back. This is Prime Time.
This is Rupert Brown, better known in the community as Major Brown. Because of my service in the police, I've been with NAGICO for the past 30 something years. I think it's around 35. And I've always been satisfied with the service I got with them. They have helped many people in this island. As long as I have to keep on insuring them with any company, I will choose NAGICO.
Every time I go to NAGICO, I get the best service that I needed.
I think it took a little longer to be paid out, but I could understand they had to bring in the people out from outside. The damage was so great that they needed people from outside to make the assessments, and that took a little longer. But in the end, I was satisfied that I had people in NAGICO who you consider friends, and that's why I've remained with NAGICO all these years, because of the friendliness of the people in there.
Choose strength. Choose reliability. Choose NAGICO Insurances.
A cruise is a great adventure. Not only for passengers, also for us. The Port of St. Martin. Our port always reflected the needs and aspirations of the time. From the first to the 1.75 millionth passenger in 2013. Our cruise story started in 1963 with our first cruise passenger. 50 great years later, 20 million passengers later, thousands of cruise berths later, we've become the leading port in the Caribbean. 50 fantastic years, like a dream. The dream of Port St. Martin lives on and reinvents itself every day. The best is yet to come.
Welcome back, and this is Prime Time. Today we are speaking to MPs Melissa Gum and MP Raeyhon Peterson. That they are the members of the PFP party, and they've been in government for a few months, and we thought it'd be a good idea to invite them in. And they, thank God, both feeling much better after that little scare with that COVID-19. And so we're so happy to have them with us on the program. Now, so before we took a break, I was saying, so now that you're in parliament, I'll go to MP Gums first. What's on your list of things that you would really like to see accomplished in this season?
Well, there are a few things that we are working on with our faction staff to kind of pick up. You know, there's a pending list of national ordinances that are at various stages in the legislative process. So that's a place that we've decided to start at. Some of it, you know, we are holding close to the chest until we have some details worked out so that we can then put out in one shot what we intend to be working on. And also trying to get outside of Parliament what PFP had originally discussed before we even entertained an election, which is, you know, getting back into the habit of town hall meetings, whether virtual or not. COVID really put a lot of plans to the side for everyone, I think. But that's something that we're now trying to work back into our scheduling to kind of get back on track with, because it is still something that we want to do. It's a promise we made to the public, and it's one that we plan to uphold.
MP Peterson, I'm curious to ask you if you all were surprised with such good showing at the polls, because you were the new party, the new kids on the block. How what was the reception behind the scenes with that?
Well, it was very interesting because, you know, we as PFP, of course, we understood that we were a new party and we were not expecting much. To say that we were expecting 2 seats would be a lie. We were all, you know, feeling that if we get 1 seat, guys, then we are very lucky, you know, that we actually accomplish something. And then, you know, once the night, you know, continued and, you know, the polls started to come in, and you know the amount of votes started to come in, and at some point MP Gums, I remember, was keeping track of the numbers, and at some point she was just like, what's going on? And and I think that was my reaction as well. And especially for me, seeing the fact that, you know, I have a background that I lived in Curacao before I went to Holland, then I came here. Let's say I did not attend high school or elementary school in St. Martin. So for me, it was very surprising to see that my numbers were up.
Yeah. And
so now is the time to actually prove to the people that, you know, we belong here. And that's what we're doing.
Right. Now, MP Gumbs, did you ever leverage on your father's experience in government and advice that he would had given you, I'm sure, with campaigning and then now you're in government? Did you tap his brain for some words of wisdom, ideas of wisdom?
I remember talking and explaining our campaign plan to him, and he just looked at me like, that's not going to work. I said, well, you know, we want to try it. So you know, we did very differently. Mm-hmm. I always said that I'm very much against the rally, loud noise, trailer, traffic jam method. I attended many of those in my childhood. You know, so we wanted to do it completely different. So everyone agreed. It was just going to be very intimate town hall meetings with people in different districts. And we weren't going to give away food. When I said that,
no food.
Some of my candidates looked at me like, what? And I said, yeah. I said, well, instead, we're going to invite a local caterer to come and sell snack boxes. Mm-hmm. And, you know, to change it, because I can't say on a stage that I'm 100% for, you know, supporting and promoting local small business, and then I'm just handing out free food and drinks. Nobody knows where it comes from. Nobody knows anything. So, yeah, we wanted to do that. So I listened. He gives advice, and I think he'll probably say, you know, that I'm pretty stubborn, but it doesn't mean I have to take it. However, it is always appreciated. There's a wealth of knowledge there, and it's not just from him. It's many others in the community that have that knowledge and that history and know how to apply it to actually relate it to the current situation in a positive way that helps find solutions, you know, because some know the history, but kind of trapped by it. And I always say that it's good to remember what came before, but if you get stuck there, you're never going to actually go forward.
Expectations. What are your expectations opposed? Yeah, you're going in, you have certain expectations, and bam, you're faced with reality. MP Peterson, want to answer that? What are your expectations versus what the real story was when you got into government?
Well, to be honest, I did not expect to become a parliamentarian. So the days after that, you know, given my history then, what was happening with my history of Romy, and how I was also moved to the side, which we thought was a politically, you know, it was very political to my opinion. So the days after that were sort of basically a brainstorming session, just, you know, trying to figure out, okay, how are we actually going to do this? How are we going to put our manifest into play? How are we going to actually serve the people as we have been doing throughout the campaign? Because that's the theory that a lot of people have, is that when these new political parties come up, they have a lot of nice promises when it comes to campaign time. But right after that, it's something that they call the off season, everything just goes dead. And we as PFP, that was one of the things that we all as candidates decided, you know what, guys, there is no off season, and that is something that we all have to be agreeing on. Now it's as important as it was right before the campaign to go out and talk to the people to find out what's really the problems and to bring it back. So that was something that, you know, we had the principle for, but that we actually had to put into action. And I think that, you know, COVID kind of like put a wrench in the matter, but you know, that's still the mission, and that's still the main mission. And you know, hopefully within the next 6 months, because now we are 6 months in, let's see, within 6 months we can actually see, you know, some improvement and some of our manifesto points actually being handled.
What about cooperation between the parties and members of parliament? MP Gumbs, want to enlighten us about that? What would you say about the cooperation with the parties and the members of parliament?
I think that for the most part, we have been able to agree on just some base principles and some basic, you know, thoughts. You see a lot of it, especially when it comes to this, to the proposed Kingdom Consensus Law and the entity, the Caribbean Reform entity. You know, we hold a difference of opinion in the manner in which things are going about now, but for the most part, you know, we had issues with the how the entity was presented, which is why we voted in July to say no to how it was presented initially. Yeah. But we also have been championing, you know, continuing discussions. Look, and also keeping the lines of communication open, basically, with not just with all our kingdom partners. And I think that kind of has had people thinking like, okay, but then are you for it or are you not for it? And yeah. I tried to make that clear that, look, we said we're not for it in its current form. And that, right. You know, government sent a counter proposal, which was sort of reworked law. And, you know, I think from a basic negotiations point of view, maybe that wasn't the way to go with a counter proposal. You know, there are other avenues, mm-hmm. and you see a Ruben Curacao still keeping the doors open.
Okay.
And that is really the important, that's dialogue, that's negotiation. It's not, you didn't accept my initial counter, so I'm gonna not talk to you anymore and say that you shut the door. It's continuing to talk. It can take a while, which is why we've been urging it to happen, mm-hmm. since April, May. And I think, I think that from that perspective, there may be a difference in style, but right. generally, you know, the basic principles of it, I think we do agree on. So it's, you know, there's a couple of times where we can say, okay, we see ourselves in this motion or in this presentation or in what is being mm-hmm. said. And then there's times that we don't. And that right. is part of
I suppose that's what opposition does.
Well, yeah. It's not disagreeing for disagreeing's sake. It's
right, exactly.
Everything in time of crisis. And sometimes that means weighing what is more important, you know, being able to yeah. say, you know, I have a 1,000% autonomy, or learning that life in global politics is give or take.
Yeah. Okay, we'll take a break and then we'll come back in our final segment. Do you think that government is doing enough to help people in this pandemic situation? So stick around and we'll be right back. This is Prime Time. You can see this program and all other programs on Facebook and on YouTube as well. We'll be back in a second.
The Daily Herald is my first source for up-to-date information and news. Putting together this program of Prime Time requires research and knowledge of current events. For local news, regional and international news, do read the Daily Herald.
So I'm going to start with you, Abigail, and then we switch over to Ebby Peterson. And the question is, do you think government is doing enough to help people in this really dire situation with this pandemic that we are going through?
I think in the early months that government has tried their best, you know, we saw the responses where it pertains to the SSRP, to the attempts then to grant some kind of relief support to especially yes. the private sector, mm-hmm. which has been the hardest hit by this COVID pandemic. However, I do think, and have expressed it as well on the floor of parliament, that government, I think perhaps needed to be a bit more proactive when it came to figuring out a plan. You know, from February, you could have seen that this was going to kind of spin out of control from a global perspective. And I remember saying that, you know, whether or not we lock down, the world is going to lock us down for us.
Right.
Because once everyone else shuts down, it's, you know, the region is basically on standstill. And I think, you know, the fact that we haven't been presented with a thought out, written out plan for how we're going to move forward. I even remember mm-hmm. saying to the Prime Minister in one of the meetings about these conditions and about the support and the entity and what was coming. I said, you know, be sure that we have a what then to tell the people. And that was in May or June or so, and mm-hmm. and now it's September. And last week, Friday, the Minister of Finance told us, you know, we have liquidity maybe till the end of October.
Right.
That's where I believe that government has seriously dropped the ball and stumbled. And people always say, well, why can't you find solutions instead of problems? But we have given those suggestions. Like I said, we've been saying since June, you know, you have to have an answer for what then? If it's a no to future aid from the Dutch government, then what comes after that?
What comes after that? Yeah. MP Peterson, what's your take on the closure of the border, really quickly?
Well, I would be biased with this answer because my daughter is French and the mother of my child is French as well. So if they were not by me in the house, which, you know, I made sure that that happened before the borders closed, then I would have not seen my daughter for the last month because it is difficult to reach to the other side if you don't really have a reason as per the rules. Yeah. You know, so me, we always campaign on, you know, it's one people, it's one St. Martin. We, regardless which side you were born or which passport you have, we both live on the island of St. Martin. And, you know, we both pay taxes on both sides of the island. So, to my opinion, the border closure, of course, that is something that needs to be dealt with on an international level. That's something for the king to decide on. But my personal take on it was that it was not necessary. And, yeah, that's basically how I feel about it, especially in such a small country. I mean, there's an island. We're surrounded by water, so we're not going anywhere, you know. So I did not understand the logic behind the border closing. But, of course, you know, maybe the French side does have their reasons that they have
to...
Or their French law as well, you know, so you have to respect that as well.
Now, this is our program, our first program doing Zoom. Do you think this is the new way forward? What do you think, MP Melissa Gumbs?
I think it will be like this for quite some time.
Are you liking it? Because that's how you're doing, that's how you are communicating in government now.
Yes and no. Yes, because we can still continue to have meetings and continue to conduct the people's business. No, because working from home is nice, but when home is literally the only office that you know, it kind of blends everything together, so there's no disconnect at the point in time. Yeah. But I think, and also too, you lose that ability to, there's something that you cannot really do online that you can do face-to-face. You know, for example, we had IPCO in June, and it wasn't the same as if we had traveled to the Netherlands for this conference, so to speak.
Yeah.
You know,
you don't,
especially as a new MP, you know, I didn't have the opportunity to really meet my colleagues from the other islands in the Netherlands and sit with them and talk with them. You know, there's in business school, they tell us all business is done on the golf course. Yeah.
Okay, MP Peterson, MP Gumbs, thank you so much for joining us on the program. Well, you all are what we would call real troopers because this is our second try. And I think this second try looked better than the first one. And so we thank you and we appreciate your time.
Thank you.
And good luck. And keep healthy. Yeah. Keep encouraging all of us to wear our masks, social distance, and to wash our hands. And glad seeing you and all the best. And we'll see you soon in another edition of Prime Time. Thank you so much for watching. This has been Prime Time. I'll see you next week. And bye.